media or whatever the media we come across, it is really to some extent disturbing, really disturbing. Where to mark the line, where to demarcate the line, it is up to us. And what is being communicated to the media, and why it is communicated, and how it is communicated, what is the message that every person is trying to communicate to the society? Is it the message of love or something else? Therefore, I think the resource persons, we have a galaxy of resource persons who will speak to us on this wonderful topic of using journalism or the media more responsibly in today's world, so that all the people live peacefully, all the people enjoy the reading the dailies or whatever the media they come across. Therefore, I once again invite all of you. I was reading a book very recently. I was reading a book. The book's title is Success Through PMA, Positive Mental Attitude. It's written by Napoleon Hill. He speaks about the entire book, discusses about the positive mental attitude, which will help us to have a peaceful life or joyful life in today's world. Similarly, the dailies or the media with which we interact every day should also help us for a joyful and happy life. Therefore, I'm sure the resource persons will enlighten all of us on this wonderful topic. And before I actually end it, I would like to tell the resource persons and other persons about our college, St. Saviour's College. St. Saviour's College was established in the year 1923. It is on the southern end of Tamil Nadu. It was established by the Jesuit fathers. It is in its 98th academic year. In another 2 years' time, we will be celebrating 100 years of its existence. And in the last year, month of August, the NAC peer team visited our college and it accredited us A++ with 3.66 out of 4. Therefore, right now, we are in the second in the whole country in terms of offering quality education. It's not to everybody, it is to the marginalized and deprived sections of the society. For your information, we admit around 65 to 75% of the poor sections of the society. Therefore, the students whom we are educating is from downtrodden section or marginalized section. And at this juncture, I should appreciate Father Inyasi, the vice principal and the HOD of the visual communication department, who has taken lots of efforts to reach out to the deserving students, not only for ISCOM students, but also for other disciplines. Therefore, I appreciate him for taking this particular effort of inviting the eminent speakers to enlighten the present students. And I also thank all the resource persons for having accepted to share your knowledge to enlighten our students. Once again, I extend a very warm welcome to all of you. Please enlighten all of our students. Thank you very much. May God bless all of us.
Thank you, Father. I will now like to introduce the panelist and the moderator for today's webinar. And before that, I just like to inform you some of the objectives of this workshop. The idea is the learning curve should not get stopped due to the pandemic. It should continue. And that is one of the reasons why we thought that we should continue our engagement with the young people, let them know what is the issues which is affecting the world currently. We want the young people need to learn more about the issues that are affecting the adolescent and young people across the world. And through their skills, because we are orienting the ViSCOM students, we strongly believe that whatever they learn, they can apply this knowledge into their daily life through their skills that they acquire in the institution. to have more discussion on today's topic, the journalism in the time of COVID. We are happy to have Mr. Shashi Nair with us. Mr. Nair is the director of Press Institute of India and editor of its journals, Vidura Grassroots and RIND Rind Survey. Earlier, Mr. Shashi Nair was consulting editor for Van Ifra, World Association of Newspaper and News Publishers, editor supplements of the Economic Times. He was also the chief copy editor of Times of India Chennai edition and the assistant editor of the Hindu Business Line. Mr. Nair was a columnist for the New Indian Express, and for many years wrote on heritage, sports and civic issues for Madras Musings and The Hindu. Nair has also co-authored with Mr. S. Muthaya the corporate biography of L&T ECC called 60 Landmark Years, and contributed to few books on the history of Madras and some of its prominent citizens. Mr. Shashi Nair began his career as a direct recruit officer with the United India Insurance Company, a subsidiary of General Insurance Corporation of India. After 8 years, he moved to TTK Group, where he had a decade-long stint as a head of public relations and corporate communications. Welcome, Mr. Shashi Nair, for today's webinar. We are happy that you will be moderating the entire discussion.
Thank you.
We are also happy to welcome Dr. Mrinal Chatterjee. Dr. Chatterjee is a journalist turned media academician. He was born in 1961 and has completed is a complete media person who has worked in almost all media with Elan. He did his master's in mass communication, public administration and English. He did his PhD from Berhampur University, Orissa in 2007. He received 2 weeks trainer's training on conflict reporting by Thomson's Foundation in Cardiff, Welbeck First and London in 2006. He started his career as a lecturer in English, soon to join Sambad, leading Odia daily in 1984 as sub-editor, and became editor in charge of its Northern Orissa edition in 1996. He has been awarded the prestigious K.K. Birla Foundation Fellowship in 1996 and the Journalist Fellowship by Center for Science and Environment, New Delhi in 1991 and 92. He joined Indian Institute of Mass Communication as Associate Professor in February 1999. He has become Professor and Head of the Eastern India Campus of IIMC located in Dhenkanal, Orissa in June 2008. Dr. Chatterjee has published 6 books on journalism and mass communication, including his seminal work, History of Journalism in Orissa. He is a popular columnist who writes in Oriya and English, an accomplished fiction writer. He has published 7 novels and 6 short stories collection. Many of them have been widely translated. I would welcome Dr. Chatterjee for our webinar today. Sir, we are happy to have you for our webinar today, and we expect it is going to be a rich discussion and informative for all our students. Welcome, sir.
Thank you, and I also am looking forward to this webinar. Thank you very much.
Our second speaker for the webinar today is Ms. Kavita Muralidharan, a bilingual journalist from Tamil Nadu with 2 decades of experience covering a wide range of issues from politics to culture and cinema. She started working in 1998 with News Today, an evening newspaper based out of Chennai, and has worked with major publications including the Hindu Group, India Today and The Week. She was part of the team that launched the Hindu Tamil and was heading its reporting section before moving to India Today Tamil to take over as its associate editor. Kavita writes largely on politics on Tamil Nadu, but also has deep interest in cinema and literature. She has been writing regularly on cultural scenario of Tamil Nadu in various publications. She has consistently written on human rights and women issues besides the issues of the marginalized in the state. She has done a series of stories from Sri Lanka on its civil war and aftermath and how it had affected its ordinary citizens. Kavita has won the PIA ICRC prestigious award for reporting on for a story on Sri Lankan war in 2009 that was published by The Week magazine. She has also been a recipient of numerous awards, including the Vijay TV's Best Woman Journalist Award in 2014. Kavita now volunteers with People's Archive of for Rural India as a translation coordinator. She is currently a senior reporting fellow with People's Archive for Rural India and also an independent journalist contributing to major print and online news magazine. Kavita, we welcome you for this webinar today. I'm sure our participants are going to learn a rich experience of yours in covering stories during the difficult circumstances. Welcome once again, Kavita.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. I look forward to the discussions.
Our third speaker for the webinar today is Ms. Lasya Shekhar. Lasya is a senior reporter at the Citizen Matters, an independent online civic media website supported by Urvani Foundation in India. Before joining Citizens Matters, she worked as a reporter with Deccan Chronicle, a mainstream Delhi newspaper. In 5 years of her reporting career, she has written extensively on environmental issues, women and child rights, and other critical social and civic issues. At Citizens Matter, she has been experimenting with diverse formats varying from photos, videos, and infographics for an interactive content presentation. Her articles have created a significant impact on number of occasions, with Southern Bench of National Green Tribunal initiating so moto cognizance based on her reports on beach encroachment and Willivakkam lake pollution. Shortly after her report on the illegal liquor shops in Padur, which was published, the Ministry of Women and Child Development took cognizance of the report, and Menaka Gandhi herself had written to the Kanchipuram collector to look into the issue. Lasya is a proud recipient of Inspiring Women Award by SAIL Foundation in October 2017. I would like to welcome Lasya for our webinar, and I'm sure, Lasya, our students are going to learn a lot from your insights that you have been carrying forward during the reporting on these issues, ranging from women and child rights to the other social issues in the society. Welcome, Lasya.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much for the invite.
Now, over to you, Sashi, for our discussion today.
Thank you, Shugato, for those elaborate introductions. And thanks to the principal, the father who brought open the subject of freedom rights. But I think we are going to discuss some of the experiences journalists have had in covering stories during COVID. Am I audible, everyone?
Yes.
Sugar? Yeah. It's a pleasure to have Dr. Mrinal. Mrinal, where are you? I need to see you. Last year, I can't see you. And yeah, I can. And okay, fine. So it's a pleasure to have you, Doctor, on our show. And it's been a long time since we met. I know you came to the Press Institute of India some years ago. We haven't met after that. But one of the things that Shugato forgot to mention was that Dr. Chatterjee has been a regular contributor to our journal, Vidura, where he's run a series.
Yeah.
The first series has been on the history of journalism, covering various languages from Bengal to Urdu to Marathi to Oriya to Tamil, etc. So that's, I think, gone to more than 15 or 16 such articles. And then he's gone on to also start another series which looks at the great Indian editors, many of who we hardly know. And that's an ongoing series. So since we are addressing a group of students, I would suggest that they can log on to the Press Institute of India website, go into the archive section, and look for some of these articles from our issues that are uploaded there. Incidentally, I'm also a student of St. Xavier's College, but that was in Calcutta many years ago. So it makes me feel good to address students here in Palayam Kote. I'm also happy that Kavita and Lasya readily agreed to join this. And the reason we wanted both of you was because you've been doing stories during the COVID period, and you know, more than speeches, what I was looking at and what Sugata and I were looking at, you know, was a sort of a conversation where we could discuss some of your experiences, and through experiences is what really comes out fair and square. We all know what we are undergoing these days. I think a lot has been spoken about it, written about, etc., etc. But one of the things is that it's changed lifestyles so much that it's quite unimaginable. It is quite unimaginable, come to think of it. So how are journalists faring in this scenario? What it is, or what can it be to work from home for a journalist or a photographer or a photojournalist, people who are supposed to be there out on the field? Let me start with you, Doctor. What are your feelings on this? Because you've probably coached maybe a couple of generations of students. You've seen the media world as long as I have. We've both never experienced anything like this before, certainly not in the media world, where newsrooms have also changed dramatically and have had to adapt. What is your take on this, on how it is for a journalist to really sort of look at working from home? We'll start with you and then move on to Kavita and Lasya.
Thank you. Let me borrow a couple of sentences from Charles Dickens. He started his novel, A Tale of Two Cities, with this sentence: "It is the best of the times and it is the worst of the times." I guess that holds true for journalism today, and especially field journalists today. Never before in our lifetime we had to face this kind of situation, this pandemic. It has locked up everything. It has shut down almost practically everything. The economy is on a downward spiral. Never before we have seen people walking home barefoot, dying on the road. Last time we had seen something like this in 1947, when the country was divided. Never before we have seen people so scared within the house, and never before negative was so positive, like it's the new normal. And in this situation, a journalist has to work. This is a challenge for the journalist. This is an opportunity for the journalist, an opportunity to be engaged with a new system of working. I mean, how do you report something without going there? Or if you have to go there, I mean, there are certain cases where you have to go there no matter what. Like a photographer cannot take photograph of something without going there, unless he uses satellite technology, I mean, which is not presently available with us so easily. It's available, but not so easily. Now, so there are risks for the journalists, and many of the journalists have undertaken these risks. Lesson learned: that we have to learn to work in this kind of situation. The safety measures that the journalists need to take, that is what the journalists had to learn. The journalists, the sub-editors needed to learn how to work from home and make pages. In the COVID situation, many of the newspapers asked their staff to remain at home and work from home. Sub-editors, for the first time in their life, remained at their home and made pages and sent it across to the office to print it. Never before it had happened. So what I'm trying to tell you is that, A, for some journalists, it was an opportunity to learn new tricks of the trade, learn new things for their reporting and editing work, learning new safety measures, learning new ways of reporting. I mean, journalists are now working from home, getting all the information from other sources, from internet, from other sources. They have to mine data, put them together. Like, it's a whole new ball game. So, Mr. Nair, to answer your question, it has been an opportunity and a great challenge for the journalists. The journalists needed to take great risks. They took it and they paid for it, for that also. Now, somebody else can take over.
Yeah, thanks, Doctor, for sort of setting the tone. Kavita, what has been your experience? And of course, last year, we'll first have Kavita talk. But what your experience has been, I think you'll have to unmute, Kavita, on what your experience has been. But before that, how did it feel when, probably maybe mid-March, end March and April, things started getting bad? Then we had the lockdown announced, etc. What were the kind of feelings you all went through? Because you still had to do stories. And Dr. Chatterjee has spoken about the safety part. You can weave that in a bit as well. Whether that came about or you had to find your own way. Kavita?
Yeah, thank you so much, sir. Mid-March, I was actually planning to travel to Salem for a story. Around March 20th, I thought I had spoken to my contacts there. I had made all the arrangements to do the story on and come back in 3 days. So March 20th, that was supposed to happen. And then suddenly things got developing and I realized I cannot go. It was my immediate reaction was I was very, very disappointed because I've still not been able to do the story. I think maybe next month I'll try and go there again. But as a journalist, I think you need to be in the field on the ground to report. Otherwise, the strength of the reporting is the field, going to the field and going on the ground. So for the first 2 months, March and April, I've not been able to go out. And that was very disappointing. But I still tried to, the new normal, as Mr. Mrinal Chatterjee said, was to speak to people over phone and get the details and do stories about them. Luckily for me, on a couple of stories that I had worked, one was an apparel artist who was using that art form to create awareness on COVID. I have already known him very well. So, speaking to him over phone was not a problem. The other one, I did a story on the school in Nagapattinam catering to the tribal people. I have been to the school several times. So it also didn't matter much that I was talking to them over phone and getting all the details, but I would have still preferred to go there in person and do everything. Still, the new normal to me was to talk to people over phone. I do that sometimes, like when it's a political story and I have to get reactions, not an elaborate piece and all. I get reactions over phone and do it. But for me, it was a new normal. Doing an entire story over phone was the new normal. But I did go to Gumudi Pundi. Mr. Chatterjee rightly pointed out how we have, like after 1947, this was a very historic moment where all of us would have seen, but I also saw hundreds of thousands of migrant laborers going through Gumudi Pundi to various other parts of the country. It was I couldn't write on it because I was not prepared to record what I saw. Like I was there for 2 days and the migrant laborers were not even willing to stand and speak to the journalists there because they were carrying all the luggage. And I thought it was unethical on my part to stop them and get a bite or get a coat or something like that. So I just watched them go. They would stop. I was near a volunteer camp where some of my friends were volunteering. So they would stop to pick up a water bottle or to pick up a biscuit packet. And that's when we tried to chat with them. Most of them were not too keen to give any responses because what are they going to get by answering my question? So I didn't also want to trouble them, but it was a very gut-wrenching sight for me to see thousands of people walking through the streets carrying in the hot sun, how April, May and all is in Chennai, like in the hot sun carrying their luggages and sometimes the kids and the women also doing it. It was, for me, it was a very historic tragedy. And I've not been able to document it. I thought I would go there and see if I can do a story. And finally, I decided, I shouldn't be, anyway, people were writing about it, documenting it, and a lot were being written about it. So I just wanted to be there and see what's happening. But for me, that was a very transformative moment as a journalist, because it was historic at one level. It was very moving, it was gut-wrenching, and it made all of us feel very guilty about what's happening. It made all of us feel very helpless about what was happening. Also, when we talk about, maybe we'll come back to that later, but
we got the kind of flavor that you was talking about, the sheer helplessness one feels in these situations.
Yeah.
And also being there to have seen all that is also, I think, quite remarkable, because that is also the historic part that you mentioned. Last year, what's your experience? And before that, how did you feel? Can you just narrate some of those initial days and then when you settled down with, you know, covering stories during COVID?
It's a difficult situation. There's a pandemic where there are hundreds of stories that excite you, but you cannot go out and report on them. That was a difficult situation to deal with. But, also because, like, I agree with Kavita ma'am that it's your strength to go to the field. You can get information even if you don't go to the field, you know, but it's a whole different story. You know, it reflects on the output. When you write the story, you go there not just to get information, but also to get inspired with it, you know, like with Kavita ma'am was rightly telling about how when she saw migrants walking, it kind of saddened her. So certain things were like that. So, but initially I could not go to the field. So my biggest challenge was also to get the information because the officials were dealing with a bigger thing. They were not ready to talk to journalists. And you have to rely only on the press releases sent by the different departments of Chennai or the state or country. So that was the only way. And you have to, it was very difficult to get the information in the first place. But even that can be, I could try different ways, you know, maybe social media or accessing the websites or getting it because most of the departments, you know, kind of enhance their presence on websites, on social media, to churn out the information. For me, the biggest challenge was to feel the story, you know. Sometimes when you see the person suffering, that kind of, you know, that gives you words. When you don't see that, it kind of gets mechanical. It's more like a news report, but not a, you know what I'm trying to say. You don't the soul of the story kind of is missing. So that was one of the challenge for me. And I could I kind of adapted to the crisis, but that's another thing. We'll talk about it again. So this was my challenge: access to the information and feeling the soul of the story was something.
Yeah, I think you captured it fairly well, because especially for a journalist, it's not just about sort of armchair reporting where you don't meet people, and when you meet people, you get excited, inspired, and there is a feeling. That can't be captured in words.
You go to the field thinking that you want to do one story, but when you go to the field, two, three stories come out, and you that excites you. That was one feeling that I kind of missed that feeling. You know, I had not never in my life had I struggled so much to get a good story idea. But during the pandemic, that was very tough, because when you don't go to the field, when you don't go to people, it's also tough to get people to trust you, you know. Like when you ask them information over the phone, they will not tell you as much as they would do it on the field, you know. Like when you go to the field, you try to spend some time, you just don't ask them questions right on. You just spend some time with them, try to gain their trust. And then when they're comfortable, you try to give them that comfort level to talk. So that was also missing. So you have to satisfy yourself with the information you get, and getting inspired was the biggest challenge.
Yeah, of course. As we all know, you know, the good journalists have to be there at the scene. Photographers in any case have to be. So it's far more difficult. You're handicapped in a way when you can't do that, and yet you have to report with feeling. So is Kavita there? I'd just like to go back to a story you did. Kavita, are you there?
Yes, I'm here.
Okay. So you mentioned a couple of stories, and in fact, I did, have a quick look. We'll talk about some of the stories that both of you have done, and maybe you can bring out some of the experiences there. The one story that you mentioned was about the school. And I think you've called it Vanavil. I think it's the Tamil word for rainbow, right? So it's rainbow in the midst of gloom or something like that. So I think this is a visit. You visited a primary school. It's in Nagapattinam district, right? And you mentioned in your story that the school serves mainly students from nomadic tribes. And even though it's been closed for classes, the school or the authorities there have been arranging groceries for families in Arasur and other villages. This particular village is called Sikkal village. So they've been arranging groceries for families and all that during this period of COVID. Am I right?
Right.
And so in a way, the school has become a center of, you know, nutrition for what, 1,000 families or something in these hamlets. So can you narrate some of your experiences when you visited and, you know, what it was like during this time?
Actually, I didn't visit it, visit the school this time because there was no, there was no way I could go to the school. But I've been going to the school since it started in after tsunami, I think in 2006 or so it was started. Since then, I have been visiting the school once in 2 years or once in 3 years. So I was very familiar with the place. I was very familiar with the system there. And I had an idea when I spoke to many people over phone, I had an idea what they were doing. So even before COVID, the school was doing an extraordinary work because Vanavil was born out of a need. You know, the it started with, I mean, the Vanavil's correspondent and founder called Revati. She started, she went to Nagapattinam. She was into films. She was an associate director for Gautam Vasudev Menon. But she started volunteering after tsunami, which is when that she found out even like during tsunami, there was so much of relief work available. But I knew I had covered tsunami in 2004. So I know that there was so much of relief work available. At least 300 NGOs had camped in that small district of Nagapattinam to help people out. But even in that situation, the nomadic communities of the Narikuravar and Bumbumattikarar communities were discriminated. They were not getting relief work. So Revati was very struck by the fact that they were discriminated in relief work. And that's how she started this Vanavil school, which was initially intended as a bridge school to put them back to the mainstream school. But now it's a school on its own. So they, these communities, their job is to go, you know, go and sell stuff. Especially in the tourist areas of Nagapattinam, Velankanni. So when it, when under a lockdown, when they were not able to do it, and there's just hands-to-mouth existences. All of us know how nomadic tribes live. So when they were not able to do that, it was becoming a huge problem. That's when the school, a residential school, which also had 100 children staying there, it doubled up as this agency which supplied groceries, which raised money to get them groceries. I thought it was very fascinating and it was very important because for the I spoke to many families who've received this grocery and they told me before that they had stayed hungry. They had to kind of starve. They didn't know what to do. They can't go to any other place. And the government was not doing much about this. That's when the Vanavil started distributing groceries and they've been able to sustain, survive for some time. So that
I mean, quite a fascinating story, I thought. And also at a time like this, you know, when, I mean, such stories hardly come out, you know, even during normal times. But at this time to do such a story was, I thought, quite remarkable. We'll come back to your second story. But before that, I just like to ask Lasya, are you there, Lasya?
Yes.
Yeah, yeah. So you see, the other thing is now we're going back to, or maybe going to, you know, where all this, you know, action is. It's about nurses, doctors and nurses. Nurses, of course, during, I mean, we all call them as superheroes and things like that. They work in very close proximity, you know, with COVID patients. And of course, we know that many of them have lost lives as well. And some of them have been away from their families for months. And, it's also about working long hours, and then they and then their payments are also not there for them on time, but still they continue doing their job and they do not abandon their duty. Now you've done a couple of stories. We'll come to the first one, which I found quite interesting, and this was you mentioned the name of the woman here. Her name is Kumari, and this you know, for those who are watching, is a story done by Lasya, which appeared in Citizen Matters. And it is about how it is like to be away from your breastfed infant for about 2 weeks. So if you would like to know, she says, ask a nurse in Chennai who is a lactating mother. Now, Kumari has a tough and choiceless job. She works 12-hour long shifts for 5 days at a stretch. So you can just think about it and imagine how it can be for her. And now all this time, she's attending to COVID-19 positive patients and being away from her family. And after that, she has to be again away for 9 days, says Lasya. And while Kumari is busy checking the vitals of patients and assuring them of speedy recovery, her baby is being fed on formula milk. So how easy was it, or how difficult was it for you, Lasya, to do this story? Did you speak to her on the phone? Did you visit the hospital? Can you just talk about it a bit?
Yeah. So I think I should thank the photographer in Deccan Chronicle, because one of the few things I had to do was I used to talk to reporters across Chennai just to know what's happening, those who are on the field. So this is the photographer from Deccan Chronicle, Sampath sir, who was on the field and who said that nurses are suffering. That was from that point I had to, I kind of gathered the contacts of few nurses and I started talking to them, not right on. Like I took 1 or 2 days. At that point, one of the nurse was telling me that she has symptoms of COVID-19 and she has given the test. So I just, I would just call her again every day and ask what the result was, and how is she doing. I genuinely felt about it. I genuinely felt that she was doing a good job, and so I had asked her. But I did not know that made her, that kind of gain. She kind of trusted me and she kind of started opening up. So I spoke to her over the phone, but I did go to the hospital and took the photos. But it was a risky affair to talk to these people on the field, because they're very scared to talk about it, because it was such a critical issue. And, it has been reported many times, but nothing has happened. Every time these nurses protest. Okay, since we're talking about the first story, I'll tell about this. So these nurses were telling me about, many sad stories, like how they're, even though this despite the rule from the government itself that they should not be allowed, that they should not allow lactating mothers or senior nurses or those with comorbid conditions. This has happened. So this was an interesting story. And I spoke to the nurses. The toughest part was to get the government GO. That I wanted to prove that the government is violating its own order by asking these nurses to work in COVID-19 wards.
So you are referring to an internal circular from the Department of Public Health and Preventive Medicine, isn't it? That which says that lactating nurses and those with medical conditions must be excluded from COVID-19 duty. Is that it?
Yep. Yes. So getting that, accessing that was a tough thing. But through one of the nurses and through, again, a senior official who has helped me, so I could access that. Once that was done, I spoke to the other nurses and got it. But the toughest part was to take the pictures. So when I went to the hospital, I couldn't spend a lot of time. I just took the pictures and I came out. So I didn't talk to them on the field, even though I met them. But I got the contacts of them and I spoke to them when they were in their comfort zone, when they were, out, not in the hospital, when they thought they were in a safe place. So that was how the story was done.
Yeah. We'll also move to your second story, since we're talking about nurses, before I go back to Kavita. There's another story you've written. This also is about nurses and how they are risking their lives and all that. But what are they getting in return? That's the question you ask in your story. And here you also mention names. Of course, the names are not the real names, but you talk about someone called Kripa in your story who removes her tali or the Mangal Sutra. She's a staff nurse who left for her workplace at the Rajiv Gandhi Government General Hospital here in Chennai. And the day or the time she actually removed her Mangal Sutra is always etched in her mind. It was the first time you say that she removed the tali. In so many years of marriage, and she had to be away from the family for 14 days at a stretch. Hello. Hello.
Yeah.
Yeah. So now you also mentioned about the exhausting work schedules of staff nurses in government hospitals and the sacrifices that they make. But the question you keep asking there in your story is do they receive their fair share of dues, which I think is monetary? How did you do the story? Did you take as they say, both sides of the story? The nurse angle, the people who pay them, the employers, how did you do it?
Yeah, so when I was doing the first story, it made me think, I had this question, why is this happening? And then what are they getting in return? This is something at Citizen, I work at Citizen Matters. So my editors at Citizen Matters always ask me to look beyond what you see. So that's where I started asking them, look, what's the bigger thing? What's the bigger issue here? Why are they doing this? Because nurses who were about to retire were asked to stay, and there was definitely a crunch in employees. That's one thing. And what are these people getting in return? Most of these nurses are, in government hospitals. Yeah. They're working in contract basis. They don't get a lot of, pay is very meager, like 14,000 for the experience of more than six to seven years, which is very bad. That made me question about the bigger thing. So I understood that the system itself is, wrong. They have been fighting for the equal pay wages for the past more than 6-7 years. And according to the Minimum Wages Act, this is very less, even according to the Minimum Wages Act. I think it's 18,000 minimum salary for the government people, according to the Minimum Wages Act. So that's when I understood, that there is, we contribute very less to the public health, as a country.
Hello, have we lost you there? She's back. Yeah, okay. Huh. Yeah, sorry, continue. Yeah,
so that's the bigger point. And can you all hear me?
Now we can.
Okay, so that's how, I had to speak to the experts to know about it. I spoke to the officials. I also spoke to the government officials who said, yeah, this is not, it's not in their hands. It has to come from above. And the minister had promised them that they would recruit a few people, who are working in a contract basis into a permanent thing. But that has not been happening for many years. But still, why are they in this job? Because if they are not in this job, they have to be, trapped in poverty. That's the only thing that's one thing. And also the feeling of working for government, being a nurse is one. They like to be a nurse, and they also like to say that they're working in a government sector, and they believe that government will someday or the other will enroll them in the permanent basis. So that's the other side of it.
Yeah, okay. So now coming to a slightly better part of this. Now, Kavita, you mentioned earlier, and you've done this story about the parai artists who you say are tapping into social media, and they continue to perform, lockdown or otherwise. And one of their, objectives has been to spread the message and to create awareness about COVID-19 through talks and, videos, etc. You've given the example of Mani Maran and his wife who continue to perform. And, they do live shows and videos and things. So this again is like the school story. There is a rainbow kind of a situation here, where people, the common people, are sort of using the opportunity to shine, and also make a difference to people's lives. Just like Dr. Chatterjee mentioned earlier, that using, adversity as an opportunity. Kavita, how was it doing this story?
It was remarkable. I have known Mr. Mani Maran and his wife Magirini for some years now. I have been to they run an annual camp at Vedandangal, Parai camp, where they teach Parai for 3 days. It's intensive camp. So they teach Parai for 3 days to anyone interested. Doesn't matter whatever your age, caste, creed, whatever, they teach Parai. So I have covered that camp, and I've written a profile of Mr. Mani Maran for The Wire, which I really think is one of my good stories. This was like 4 or 5 years ago, I think in 2016 or 17. But this one, I really wanted to just find out what's happening with them. It was an ordinary call of inquiring with people about how they are. And that turned out to be a story for me, because what I heard from him was remarkable. This was the man who's lost many opportunities. And despite being popular, I don't think he's financially reached that stage. I don't know if I should even say that. But this was a man who was struggling, who was lost money. The day I called him, he told me he and his troop was supposed to be in Bangladesh, and it got cancelled. So many opportunities he was missing, and still he wanted to do something about the entire COVID thing and create awareness for the people. He was stuck in Perambalur. He is from Vedanthangal, but during this corona crisis, under the lockdown, he was stuck in Perambalur.
Hello?
Can you please mute Mr. Ashok Kumar? Please go ahead.
Yeah. So he was stuck in Perambalur. From where he realized that Perambalur at that point of time when I spoke to him was not very affected by COVID, but he realized that people were having lots of myths around COVID. They didn't know what the disease was. They didn't know how to handle it. And they started believing all the stuff that was being told by any random person. That was when Manimaran realized that he should use his art to kind of create an awareness. And it's a lovely song. It's on YouTube. I suggest that all of you go and visit the song. In the song, he speaks about how corona should be handled. He speaks on it was in March, late March, end or April, early April, where he says the importance of wearing masks and, you know, washing your hands, those stuff. So for me, it was remarkable that, that a person like Manimaran is otherwise he would be doing it. But even when he is in a personal crisis, he still chose to use social media and own art. He still chose to...
Carry on. We can hear you. No problem.
Chose to use social media and his own art to create awareness. Manimaran told me that his idea of art is that. It's just that he wants to use his art to create awareness among people for the betterment of the people and all. And for him, art is a very intense political tool. And I think... he saw COVID-19 and the lockdown as an opportunity to take it to more people.
See, a couple of things I just wanted to ask before I move to Dr. Chatterjee, to you, Kavita, and to Lasya. I think, one point was mentioned already is it's difficult now, especially, to get credible information. We are living in the age of fake news. There's fake news everywhere. Now, especially, it's difficult because other than, what the government, doles out by way of information, like Lasya has mentioned, there are even sources that, the kind of trusted sources that we journalists have, they may also be a little scared to come out with information, which means that it is even far more difficult to have the right kind of information. What has been your experience, both of you, Kavita first and then Lasya, in handling this kind of a situation?
For the kind of stories I did for Pari, it was not a major problem, but I did a couple of stories for the Mint on Melapalayam on COVID there, and one on Chennai, how COVID is affecting ordinary people here. But that was very challenging for me to get. I spoke to people I haven't spoken before, I haven't known before, and it took time to convince them that I intend to do decent work of this and they can trust me.
Gurunatha.
Yeah, this is Odin.
Lasya.
Yeah. So I would say it's okay if you're not sure about the information. First thing is to get the information from government. You don't have to always call the official to get it. You can, it is time taking, but you can send a mail or you can try to access information from social media, because both Chennai Airport, Chennai Corporation, all these departments have gone online. They are publishing the update every day. And that's not something that's not everything. You might have questions about it. You might want to know more about it. So you will have to, wait for it, or you will have to, the second way is to get the information from organizations that are working on the on a particular topic. Like when I did an article about malnutrition, how Anganwadi centers have been closed and how malnutrition is playing is witnessed in the slumboard localities. Yeah. I contacted the IRCDUC, an organization which had been working on this particular subject, and I got the data from them. So we should have our sources. We should be, the first thing can be the government or then the organizations. So we can wait if the thing is authentic information is important.
Dr. Chatterjee, you'd like to ask the journalists any question based on some of their stories, or you want to let it pass? I'm sure you'll have something. Yeah.
Let me first congratulate Kavita and Nasha. And Kavita with her Sri Lanka stories, I just remember that there was a film, I'm forgetting the name of that film, John Abraham was there, and it was on Sri Lanka. And there was a character of a lady journalist. Some people told me that that character of lady journalist was created on Kavita Muralidharan. And now I see Kavita Muralidharan. I do not know for sure. But
I don't think Kavita is aware of it as well.
I do not know, but some
it's
people
the movie
told
Madras
me
Cafe.
That it was based on a real lady journalist. And she is Kavita Muralidharan. Probably Kavita had done some stories on Sri Lanka. She probably went to Sri Lanka. And that
I
is
have been to Sri Lanka several times, sir. I have been to Sri Lanka.
That is probably why people don't tell me this. But anyway, coming back to the question of right kind of information, I entirely agree with both Kavita and Asha. It's very important to get right kind of information, and it's very difficult to get right kind of information during pandemic. I would like Kavita to give some tips to the students. I can see about 178 participants are there. Many of them would be students aspiring to be journalists. I will rather request Kavita to give them some tips as to how you get right kind of information in a situation like this pandemic, when there is loads of information, but not the right kind of information. I'm thankful to Mr. Nair to have told this. Right kind of information, which a journalist can believe in and can actually use. How do we get that? Kavita.
Thank you, sir. Thanks. Okay. Whatever I am going to share in the next few minutes, I intended only for the students of journalism, because as someone with 20 years experience, I think I can share some of my experience to the students. Others, I'm very sure everyone will be more experienced than I am. So to the students, I would like to say it is going to be very difficult when you step into the field. It has been very difficult for me. It's been very difficult for last year, and now it's getting very difficult because I chose to go after stories that will make me proud at the end of the day. You can see what's happening with Indian media today. On one hand, we have television channels going after a suicide case, and not many media is actually focusing on the real issues. But people like me and Lasya, we've decided early in our careers that we will focus on real issues, and that decision will have its own pros and cons. Like, I have not been able to work in a proper mainstream place, but that has not stopped me from writing what I really wanted to write and get it across to an audience that I wanted to read. So it is going to be difficult, but don't lose your hearts. Journalism is still the best thing to have happened to me. I'm very happy that I'm a journalist. I will always be happy that I'm a journalist, because I've been able to tell stories that otherwise I wouldn't have told. You know, like, I have been able to meet so many people. It's been a very enriching learning experience for me. People like Manimaran, people like Revati, the kind of people that I meet on field every day, I learn something from them. You learn a lot of things in your colleges, in your universities, but when you're on the field meeting the right kind of people, you're going to learn a lot more than what you've actually learned in your schools and colleges and universities. So you have to decide early in your career what is your calling. If journalism is your calling, you have to take it seriously. Don't worry about the opportunities. They will keep coming for the right people. They will keep coming. If you are convinced that you are here to do right journalism, you will get the right kind of opportunities. I have got the right kind of opportunities, and I'm sure Lasya will agree with me. So once you decide that, looking for the right kind of information is going to take time. Like, when I started as a political reporter, which I'm still one. And you have this thing called beach. I was put on Congress beat in News Today. So I used to go sit in the Satyamurthy Bhavan, which is a Congress headquarters in Chennai, every day for like almost a year. And that's how I met people, develop contacts with them. And when they see your face every day, they, at one point they begin to trust you. Like, it's a long process. It's not like this might not, you might not have this time and space in television journalism, which is why I wouldn't suggest it, but personally, I've never been a television journalist. Even though I did get opportunities to work in television, but I prefer to be in print. I prefer to write. So this developing contacts is not happening in a big way in journalism today, but I think that's a very, very important thing. And to be in touch with those contacts, to be in touch with those sources, even if you're not working on a story, I think it's very important to be in touch with your sources and contacts, to meet them once in a while, to know what's happening. You might get a story. Even if you don't have any idea, if you just meet them randomly once in a month or so, you'll definitely get something. You'll definitely know something about what's happening there. So that helps a lot. And there are, like, if you're pursuing a story which requires government data, there are lots of data that should be available in government websites. Only you need to cross-check with the right kind of people. So I think that's about it.
It's always good to have independent journalists. So right. There are quite a few now. And all of you are, or at least most of you, are doing wonderfully well, because we, get so many entries for our, various awards, and many of them are from independent journalists. And when you're independent, exactly as you said, you can pursue the kind of stories you want to do. So I'm sure you will do well, and Lasia too. Lasia, any quick tips for youngsters?
Any quick tips? Kavita, ma'am, I think she has summed up very well. So, just to say, building networks, building contacts is the essential thing. I agree with her, because in the initial part of the career, you have to spend a lot of hours, attending events and going, just meeting people. You might not get anything in return, but you will have to do that, because that will be useful, it's, when you call up an official, the first thing they would say is, please come and meet me, but when you persist for information, they should have the trust to tell it to you, So that has happened. Like, the first, when they asked me to come and meet, then I would ask them again, is it possible for you to share it on WhatsApp or email? So if, when you want to talk to them in that way, you should have had some network, or you should have built that contact with them, So that's something I want to share.
Yeah, trust is, developed over a period of time. It doesn't happen immediately. Just like goodwill takes a lot of time. You can't earn goodwill overnight. All this takes a lot of time and hard effort. Like Kavita has said, she spent 1 year there at Satyamurthy Bhavan. Probably, many days just sitting and waiting, for somebody to come to talk to. But, good journalism always calls for a lot of legwork. It requires a lot of patience. It also requires a lot of understanding of how to balance when you report. Anyway, we'll talk about that later. I know what you're going to talk about, Doctor. I know you're going to talk about your book. So you can just say a few words. The monograph.
Not the book one. What I'm trying to tell right now is that with COVID situation and post-COVID, the situation is going to change, not quite dramatically, but it's going to change. The people-to-people physical contact, like you go over to our office and meet the officer and this and that, that is going to reduce, if not go altogether. So therefore, what I would suggest the young journalists or the journalism students is to learn how do you cull information from credible websites, from credible website platform, credible social media platforms. These days, all government departments are mandated to go online. So therefore, earlier, the information for which we needed to go to office, I have been a journalist for 15 years, Mr. Nair has been a journalist for many years, so in our days, we had to physically go to each office to get even the smallest of information. But now things have changed. A lot of information are there, already there on the website of the department or on the social media platforms of the department. So what I'm trying to tell you that in the present times and in the future, journalists need to develop the skill of getting information, culling information from websites, from internet, from social media sites. But they need to know what is credible and what is not, what to take and what they shouldn't take, which website to believe and which they shouldn't. These are the skills needed to develop. That's the point that I was trying to make.
Can you just add a couple of lines on the monograph, the book? That might be useful. I just saw it in the chat box. Can you just mention it aloud?
I just wrote in the chat box so that the students who might need them, might use them, they can get a copy.
No, just a couple of lines on what it is about and how you, you know, got it done.
Media in the time of COVID-19 is a monograph that we published. It contains 48 articles by journalists, working journalists, media academicians, and thinkers. It talks basically about A, what the journalists need to do in the pandemic situation and post-COVID situation. B, what they went through. C, what is the shape and status of media now, and what could be the shape and status of media post COVID-19, and how do you negotiate, how do we negotiate that situation? And lastly, the importance of having a good, throbbing, truthful, credible media for a country. These are the four aspects that has been there. Approached and written about by, as I told you, practicing journalists, media academicians, and thinkers. Thank you.
Shugato, we still have about 10 minutes before we open it. Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
Okay, one, you know, a couple of points. One, I'll start with you again, Doctor, and then go to Kavita and Lasya. We've seen a dramatic change over the last few years. It's not just because of COVID. But of course, due to progress or whatever you might like to call it, from the print platform to the digital platform. So everyone is talking digital. We're talking about digital, you know, revenues from digital. Newspapers are looking at how to earn more revenues. They are not able to. But even today, they say print is the most sustainable platform that gives, you know, that brings in the revenues. But during COVID and even up to now, newspapers have had a bad hit. The advertising is down. It's just gone down, you know, slid down. And, you know, whereas earlier you had 36 pages and 24 pages, you have about 12 pages or something even today. But that apart, for a journalist, especially for young journalists, it becomes imperative today, I think, to really know the skills of digital media. Whether it is laying out a page on InDesign, whether it is transferring the page to somewhere else, Facebook, Twitter, all that. We will talk to Kavita and Lasya about it. I think they might be experts in this. I'm not. I'm still the old-fashioned journalist. Perhaps you are better than me. But what is your take on it first, Doctor? And then we'll go to them.
Two things. One, newspapers are still the most credible news source. And I'm not saying that. There's a survey here. Luckily, it got published today. The survey was done by Ormax Media. It took about over 2,500 samples, and they did this story. And this survey says that newspapers are the most credible news providers, followed by radio, and then followed television and social media, websites and all put together, they come in the third place. So though newspaper money-wise, advertisement-wise, circulation-wise have suffered, but still they have a plank to hold on to, and that is credibility, which television sadly, very sadly, is losing. But I entirely agree with you. In the next 2 years, 3 years, I mean, the way technology is growing, you cannot predict anything beyond 2-3 years. I mean, you cannot. So in the next 2-4 years, yes, digital is going to be the more pronounced medium through which people will negotiate, engage with viewers. So therefore, our young journalists must learn the skills or to engage with digital media. Having said that, the credibility lies with print. So the ideal match will be the credibility of the newspaper and the functionality of digital media. That will be the ideal match. And let's hope that the ideal match will prevail. Thank you.
Kavita, you've been doing this for several years now. I mean, covering stories. And last year, maybe for a few years. Have you noticed any sort of change in terms of moving to digital, and trying to be a little more, let's say tech savvy? Have you had to do that, adapt? You're muted, Kavita.
Sorry, I'm sorry. Yeah, I think, like, especially after I started working with People's Archive of Rural India, I think I've learned a bit or two, because I always thought write in the print and you write for the digital media, what's the big difference? But no, working for a digital media takes a lot more effort to, as you said, about the layout, about putting it in the place, about the translation. Sometimes I coordinate and I send it to them, and sometimes they... So the layout and other things are completely different for digital media, but I think that's about it. When it comes to writing, it's almost the same. It's always been the same for me. Mm-hmm. Also, I think digital media gives you more space to write. In newspapers, when I worked with the Hindu or the Indian Express in 2000, you have to stop with 400 words or 600 words. But the digital media, I have been able to write like 1,500 words. And in average, I write about 1,000 words, and it's been published without major edits or cuts. So that way, I think the advantage of digital media, like the Wire or Pari, is that you get more space to write, and it doesn't... even then, for the students here, I just wanted to say, brevity is the key. You have to keep your articles short and sweet. You don't have to find difficult words. The idea is to communicate in a very crisp language. So I wanted to put it on record. Just because I'm saying I write 1,000-word article doesn't mean that's the norm or that is expected. The brevity is the key. But having said that, digital media allows you to write more. So that way, I think it's an advantage.
Yeah, I think the fundamentals of good journalism will always remain, whether it's print or digital, right? I don't think that should change at all. The fundamentals of good journalism will remain. And to brevity, I must also add simplicity first. Simplicity, yes. Brevity, and clarity. The most simple simplicity is you cut every third, sentence, every third word, every third paragraph, and keep you visiting your story again and again. And then you will get, 500 out of the initial 1,000 words. Okay, so Lasya, I know you're into infographics, or I think you do some page layout. Now, infographics is a big part in, newspapers today, maybe in digital media. Can you explain a bit about infographics, how that catches the eye, and what you have to do to become a good person at being, being an infographics person?
So when you work for a digital media, I think you have to multitask. You have to think of a picture that goes with. There has to be pictures. There should also be, infographics, visual elements that captures the eye. So when I was in print media, that was something that I've never done. Filing the story is what that was my job, and that was it. And giving the photo captions. But when I moved to Citizen, I had to personally. Since I go to the field, I also take the pictures. I also try to present the story in a most appealing way, with some data or some visual aspects. I mean, rather than saying that, 1,000 people have, the statistics, you can say the same statistics can be told in a pictorial, in a visually beautiful way, maybe through a graph. So I do use a few, there are many sites, many platforms for that. So I use a few platforms such as Infogram or Canva. It's very simple. You can just experiment with all these sites, and you can make your own graph, which will add value to the story. So So that's something I have adapted after moving to digital media. And we can even do Zoom interviews. That's also an adaptation in the COVID era. You don't have to go on the phone. You can do a video interview also. Podcast, yes.
Maybe someday we will call you to, you know, conduct a session for young journalists. All right.
Thank you.
So, Dr. Mridal Chatterjee, are you there with us? So we'll kind of wind up, I think. Subodh Roy is getting, he's looking at his watch, I think. So, yeah, I will leave some time for questions. There's one issue that we haven't spoken about yet. It's not possible, of course, to talk about everything. But one of the issues is we've spoken about migrant workers, we've spoken about nurses and doctors and, you know, I mean everyone. But we haven't really spoken about the sufferings journalists undergo in terms of not work alone, but also the fear of losing their jobs. Many journalists have lost jobs, pay scales have been reduced, many have been laid off. And I suspect, I don't know, we'll have to ask Kavita and Lassie about it. I suspect that there is a fear element among journalists that, you know, how long will I be here sort of thing. What is your take on this, Dr. Mrinal? Because you're from Orissa, what is the situation there and how do you read it as we go along?
The situation in one word is BAD. All capital. It's as bad as that. The journalists have been retrenched, furloughed, that's a new term which is being used. Pays have been cut, and this has been done across the country, including Odisha. The situation is bad. Livelihood for journalists is a problem now, except for few. Most of them, yes, they live with constant worry that tomorrow you do not know whether there is that job waiting for you. Job is there for you or not. Or whether by the time you reach office, the peon says, sir, aapka toh ho gaya, aap yahan se jao, ho gaya naukri. I guess that is the situation. But there are green shoots now. Now that the economy is slightly showing the symptoms of green shooting, the situation, especially in the print area, is slightly improving. It's very less, but slightly improving. The problem with the digital is monetizing digital platform has been a huge challenge. Everybody and their uncle and auntie is on digital platform now. There are so many websites, so many news sites, so many news platforms on digital. The entire platform has become so crowded that the advertisement pie is getting fragmented and there is that loss of credibility. Therefore, even if the digital media is growing digitally, when it comes to monetizing, digital media is not doing well. So the situation is bad. Situation is very opaque, let me put it that way. But there are some signs of improvement. Let's see what time holds for us.
Yeah, thanks, Dr. Kavita and Lassia, would you like to quickly chip in with some comments about what I just mentioned about journalists losing jobs and also the fear in them? You have to unmute Kavita. And also because of the fear, whether it could affect the way you work. I think that's an important point.
Right. I completely endorse the fact that the way we work is affected by the fact that we might be laid off anytime. I'm in touch, right? I'm an independent journalist, and I think this is the best time to be the independent journalist because you can choose where to write and what to write and still be writing. But what I'm trying to say is I've been in touch with friends who are losing their jobs, and it's really, really scary. Somehow I get this feeling that the companies are laying off people using COVID-19 as an excuse, not because I really want to lay off. I know a particular person whose contract has just been renewed before this COVID-19 and he's lost his job. His contract was renewed for 3 years, I think, and he's lost his job, which he never expected. So this is very scary. We'll never know what kind of future is there for many other journalists who are working in a proper media setup. And it's very scary, but I think they are trying to hold on. It's very, some of them are really brave. They are trying to hold on, trying to do stories, trying to do their regular work. But as Mr. Chatterjee said, it's very scary. It's a very bad situation. And I also think the response is kind of muted. It's always been muted, especially because people are afraid if they will be able to find another job, you know, if they will be able to, if you are seen as a troublemaker in media, you don't get a better opportunity. So especially these kind of things are acting as pressures on people who are losing jobs. But I still think we need to be more vocal about it. The journalists who keep writing and talking about the rights of other people should also assert their own rights.
Thanks. Yeah, I think we've seen little of all this in the mainstream media, and we would expect that to happen. But we did a story on Vidura, so it's still there. Okay, Lasya, you don't see any green shoots like Dr. Chatterjee mentioned? Any green shoots, things improving? Or is it still as bad as what Kavita says?
I think a lot of them, you know, first thing, major relief came from my bosses who assured that there won't be, they are not going to fire anyone using COVID-19 as an excuse. But there won't, you know, but other organizations have adapted different strategies. Like, it's like those who are working from home, they have to forgo a bit of their salaries. That was one thing. There's so many strategies that were adapted. I say that was more like a strategy because there was no other chance, the choice, but to work from home. You know, that was the situation. And, you know, the silver lining is a lot of them are trying to get in touch with other organizations. There are many international organizations that are welcoming independent journalism. There's a lot of freelance. I know people who make career in freelance journalism. So they're trying to, you know, adapt to the situation and they're becoming independent journalists. That's something I've noticed. So
from
the mainstream journalism, I don't think there would be job opportunities in the near future, but independent journalism is something we can really explore.
Yeah. So the future doesn't look too bright, at least the short-term future doesn't look too bright, according to you.
Yes.
Okay. So good. So, you know, last few words from the three of you, and then we'll go back to Sugato and try and get questions. Doctor, you have to unmute, and maybe last few words overall.
The situation is bad, but the beauty of life is the situation can change anytime. And let's hope the situation improves. Journalism in India improves, because without credible journalism, the situation will be bad. Thank you.
Yeah, Kavita.
Okay, just before this COVID, I attended a program in Dialogue College for journalists for BISCOM students, where I told them, where I made a critique of mainstream media and covering the protests against the government. But I told them, despite all these criticisms, if you give me a choice, I'll continue to be a journalist, even if the choice is, you know, like 2 crore per month salary, but I still want to be a journalist. Journalism is thriving. It will thrive. Journalism, I think, is the hope, is the last remaining hope. And to all the students, I just wanted to say, if you want to be journalist, go ahead and don't even think of being anything else, because journalism is going to be very fulfilling. It's been fulfilling for me. It continues to be fulfilling for me. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Kavita. Lasya.
So I would, infodemic is something that has happened during the pandemic, you know, fake news, and a lot of people just share it without knowing the credibility of news. So as I would ask the younger generation to at least cross-check what they're sharing, that's one thing. And about the media, this crisis is happening everywhere, you know, and then I'm sure there would be, it will get better, if not now, in a near future.
So like they say, spring always comes. So I'm sure the sunshine will come. I think the tunnel might be a little long. It might take a little time. But, you know, if you have the passion and the fire in your belly to do something, pursue it. And I'm sure you will succeed. That's the message I have for the youngsters. So thank you all very much, Dr. Kavita and Lasya. Where's Sugato Roy to take questions? Sugato, are you there?
Yeah, Sashi. Sugato, thanks for that enriching discussion. Now we open up the floor for questions. I have already received a couple of questions. Let me just take one by one. The first question was related to the right sources is more difficult during the time of emergency and pandemic. The question goes like this, how to find the right source? Because it is very difficult to find the right source for reporting during the time of emergency. Anybody would like to take that?
I think this was touched upon before, but Kavita can add. Yeah.
No, I'm just going to say what Lasya already said. You know, you have to convince, developing sources or building a network is not going to happen overnight or in a couple of days. It takes time, and it, you know, it's, if your entire career is dependent on sources or, you know, building network, I think you should better spend enough time on it. I still believe the contacts that I made early in my career are helping me real good stories today. So it's a process in learning. You keep learning, you keep making new contacts, you keep meeting new people, and that's how it works. You don't do it like for COVID-19, you don't find new contacts and you can't develop them. Journalism doesn't work that way. Whatever we see on television, whatever we tend to think is journalism today, it doesn't work that way. That I really wanted to make very clear.
Yeah, there is one more question which speaks about the quality of journalism. How do we improve the quality of journalism during the time of emergencies? Because
the answer is very simple, Sugato.
Yeah.
You patronize good journalism, you get good journalism. You patronize bad journalism, you get bad journalism. It's as simple as that. If you watch Kangana Ranaut and Riya Chakraborty 24/7, you will get Kangana Ranaut, Riya Chakraborty 24/7. It's as simple as that. Thank you.
I mean, I fully agree with you, Doctor. I mean, when we talk about journalism, it's about how do we play our major role in removing the information poverty that is existing in our society. So to remove that information poverty, we need to have the right information and communicate that information to the right people at the right place and at the right time. Because this is going to go a long way in nation building.
You see, one of the things, Sugato and a doctor, is also like, you need to find the right place. And let's say like Kavita is now an independent journalist. She's doing some good work with, you know, Sainath Pari. Sainath is a very highly regarded, journalist. So there, and also for Citizen Matters, like Lasya said, now they, you know, encourage what you are trying to do. So if you are fortunate to get that kind of support, then I think things automatically work well for you. The problem is when you are in a situation where things don't work for you, when you don't get that support, then what happens? Then you might just have to at some point even, you know, contemplate leaving and being independent.
Doctor, you had some points?
No, I was just telling you that the onus now of having good journalism in this country, the onus is on the public, on the viewers, on the readers. You need to patronize good journalism. If you do not patronize good journalism, because media is in private domain. I mean, if you want government stuff all the time, it's already there, right? It's in the private domain. There is a market and there are market principles, right? So, as consumer of news, as somebody who engages with news, who wants to get news, you need to figure out what is good and what is bad, what you should take and what you shouldn't take, right? So the responsibility now is more on the side of the readers and the audience. That's the point I'm trying to make.
I think, Doctor, your response is exactly to the question which Professor Raj has asked from Bangalore. he has put it like, will ethical reporting in journalism still be in hand looking at the way our country is going? Why do we leave country in such a mess, giving trash each and every day? I think it is not about reporting alone. It is also about how do we patronize it, how do we view it, how do we help these channels to improve their TRP. Yeah, I mean, there are many people who doesn't watch some of the channels or doesn't read some of the newspapers or the journals because they don't want to patronize those thinkings.
Sugato, I'll tell you about my mother. She is the best example of a common television viewer, right? 24/7, she'll be watching Hindi Sasbo serials. And while watching Sasbo serials, she'll be telling in Bangla, "Uff, ki kharap, ki kharap." And what bad, what bad. She'll be telling all the while, 24/7, but she'll be watching only that. I keep on telling her, why are you watching this if you are not liking this? But then she will like it. She'll be watching it. I mean, we are we? Are we in that kind of situation? Right? If we are in that kind of situation, the market will determine that we will get only that.
Correct.
We have to take some initiative, some response.
There is one more question which is directed towards Kavita. The question says, ma'am, isn't it difficult to become an independent journalist from the very beginning, since you mentioned that independent journalism is a great way to bring about journalistic freedom? Kavita?
Yeah, I'm sorry. I was a full-time journalist for about 15 years before I moved to independent journalism in 2015. And I think it's very important to be a full-time journalist, work in a proper setup, in a proper place before you move on to independent journalism, because that helps you a lot. It helps you a lot, really, to understand. Despite all the problems of a newsroom, I think it helps you a lot to be part of a newsroom, to understand how the newsroom works. And it kind of prepared me to be an independent journalist. So I will never discount the importance of being a full-time journalist. Independent journalism is also full-time journalism, by the way, because like I work more than I used to work as a full-time journalist, as a journalist attached with an organization or institution. Because I write for 4 or 5 publications, it's more work for me. Like on some days, it's really, really more work. So I think it's very important to work in a news organization. I kind of learn how newsrooms work, so you will have an idea of what you want to do when you're an independent journalist. So it's to people who ask me after spending some 5 years in newsroom if they can start off independent journalism, I say no. You have to spend another 5 years in a newsroom and learn more things before you move off to independent journalism. So that's the most important thing. It's better to start off with a newsroom. And ultimately, when things don't work out, maybe you can move to independent journalism. But I really hope that newsrooms get much better when you come back to the field, when you come to the field.
And there was a similar question from Harsini as well on this. And I think your response is very clear, loud and clear, that you need to spend adequate amount of time, adequate number of years in the newsroom to be an independent journalist.
I wanted to add to Mr. Chatterjee's point also. There are so many to the professor from Bangalore. Please, 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 if your students don't already know about independent, organizations like Citizens. Hello?
Yeah, go ahead.
So Citizens Matter or PARI or The Wire or Caravan, I suggest you start introducing them to these organizations to the students, so they'll know these organizations, they'll pick up the stories from there, and they will not believe that journalism is what they show on television. It's outside of what you see on television.
Your response is also linked to one of the question which is asked, how important is social media for the journalist?
I think all the journalists are there on social media. It's where we put out our stories, share links and interact with people. We know what's happening, the trends, but there is life outside social media also. But social media kind of gives you pointers on what's happening in terms of the trends, in terms of hashtag and all. So
I think that was the, there's no more question. If anybody has any question, would you like to ask, or else I'll pass on the session to Father Ignace.
There's no shortcut for success. That's all I can say. There's no shortcut. Yeah. You can't, and it's just like apprenticing for a doctor, for a lawyer, for any for a teacher. You have that experience of working with someone. And one of the points I'd like to mention here, I don't know what I'm sure Dr. Chatterjee will agree with me. What I find over the past several years, many young journalists who are bright, even people like Kavita and Lasya, they don't find mentors early on. You need someone to handhold a bit or to mentor you, to guide you. Now, because of competition in newsrooms between newspapers, websites, you hardly find an editor finding time to mentor youngsters. I think that is missing today.
That's a big point. And there comes the role of good media institutions. I mean, the role that the editors used to play in earlier years need to be played by the good media media institutions, media schools. That's the role of the media schools now. Yeah.
Thank you, Sashi. Thank you, our panelists. That was the last question which we had, and I'm sure all of them have got enough of insights to apply in their professional life. And I'll pass on the session to Father Ignacy for the vote of thanks. Over to you, Father.
Yes. All right. Journalism in the time of COVID-19 comes to an end. Due to want of time, I shall make my thanksgiving note very brief. To begin with, our dear Father Principal of St. Saviour's College, Palamkottai, Reverend Dr. Mariyadas S.J., who encouraged and permitted our WISCOM department to undertake this webinar initiative. I thank you, Father Principal, for your welcome note and opening remarks. Dr. Sugata, am I audible?
Yeah, loud and clear.
Wonderful. Next in line, we have a person without whom this webinar would not have been possible, Mr. Sugata Rai, Communication Specialist, UNICEF, who is the sole responsible person for this webinar to happen at all. I thank you, sir, from the bottom of my heart for your continued efforts and dialogue with me to make this webinar possible. You have done it very meticulously. Thank you. On behalf of the organizers and the participants, I extend my sincere thanks to all the wonderful speakers of the day, Dr. Mrinal Chatterjee, Ms. Kavita Murlitharan, Ms. Lasya Shekhar. Thank you for speaking to us today. We are grateful for the time and efforts you took to share your thoughts and rich experiences with our students and our faculty members and with all the participants in this webinar. Your enthusiasm is certainly contagious, and we hope to use your thoughts and suggestions shared in our daily lives. Thank you all. A special note of thanks to Dr. Sashi Nair, the Director of Press Institute of India, and one of the proud alumni of our St. Saviour's branch, and the moderator of the day. Thank you, sir, for your contribution to this webinar. Your comments and interactions added stimulating thoughts and provided much needed help to us. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Father. I'm not a doctor.
I would like to thank all the participants across the country, other parts of the country, from various universities, colleges, media institutions, and private firms, WISCOM departments, and the students and the faculty members of the Department of Visual Communications and St. Saviour's College in particular, for the cooperation and participation. I end my word of thanks by profusely thanking UNICEF for Tamil Nadu and Kerala and Press Institute of India for partnering with our St. Saviour's College Palamkottai. Truly, it is an honor and privilege to share partnership with you, UNICEF and PII. Thank you very much. Looking forward for continued collaborations. Thanks to Mr. Rajkumar Bhaskar of UNICEF and Tholamai Adiyar Chennai for coordinating. Well, we meet you all in our next webinar scheduled on the 25th September, next Friday at 11 a.m. same time, with another media talk. Please keep following for the links and updates. Thank you very much. Goodbye. Have a good day.
Thank you.